With Allah's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer, I witness there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah alone, the one and only. There is none like unto Him. And I witness that Muhammad is Allah's servant, messenger, prophet to all of mankind. We greet you, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum. Again, let me say that I want to thank Imam Rauf Abdullah, Sister Ophelia Khan, and the planning committee, organizers of this wonderful weekend of activities to raise funds for the Islamic Center. And we know Allah will bless us with success. We expect it. You should expect success with Allah's help. That center, as I said downstairs today, will become a reality. Rahmatullah, God's mercy be on you. It will become a reality. And I forgot my other friend, I was reading the Imams at the banquet Friday night, and I forgot my friend Imam Sultan Abdullah. So I apologize for that. He was there. You know, your mind be on so many things. And he wasn't in my direct sight when I was looking at the Imams. But I just saw him and we just spoke, so I thought about it later. I'm like, oh, you didn't mention Imam Sultan. But he'd never say anything. That's the kind of person he is. He's a very dear friend of mine, very dear friend. We've known each other a long time. And so I acknowledge him, and always a pleasure to see you, my friend. And of course, my buddy sitting on the front row, Jihad. Yeah, we missed one of our partners. It was dude, we had a partner. Yeah, may Allah forgive his sins and grant him paradise. Abdul Kareem Saeed, he was our brother, yes. And of course, my good friend here, Benjamin Abdul Haq, good soldier, you all know him, warrior. And good friend. I have so many friends here in the D.C. area. And what you don't know, before I get started on the subject, I used to live in Baltimore. My brother and I, right here, Fareed Abdullah, he's the second, my brother, second under me, seven of us, and I'm the oldest, and he's the second oldest. He works for the government here, HUD, he works for HUD, and he's been here, how long have you been up here now?
Since 2002,
so about 10 years. But when we left Charleston, South Carolina, I was born in Charleston, my father moved to Baltimore, and we lived in the row house over there for about 2 years in Baltimore, Maryland, and he didn't like it. So we went down to Jacksonville, Florida. Thank God he did. Now, I ain't mad with you all that live in Maryland now. He lives in Maryland. So he built him a home, beautiful home over in Waldorf. So that's why I'm staying while I'm up here. We have a beautiful house in Waldorf, Maryland. He and his wife there. So I have ties up in this area. But Florida, Sunshine State. And I always tease my brother. I said, man, I don't know, how you dealing with all that ice after coming from Florida? But I'm in Dallas now, and Dallas is a wonderful city. It's a businessman's town. You'd have a field day up there. Yeah, it's a businessman's town. Old money and new money. Technology, business, industry, banking, finance, real estate, that's Dallas. It's big money. The land of the bushes. Yep, right there. So they're building the presidential library right at SMU. In Dallas, Texas, there. We have one of our brothers that work with me, Gidawa Marzouk, you all know him, heard of him. He's on the board of the Presidential Library for President Bush in Dallas, Texas. So I feel at home when I come here. That's what I'm saying. I started all that to say I feel at home when I come here. So many friends and brothers and some sisters that I know here, and I see Rasul from over at Masjid Muhammad, and brothers and sisters there, and Bilal, John Bilal. He gets every Arabic CD that I have. Yeah, he does. He gets them all. I told him the other day, we're on verse 20, 20J. I finished it. So we took verse 20, Al-Baqarah up to 20J. And by the way, write this number down. I'm going to give you, because now I'm teaching my classes live on conference. Live. You can join right in live. Oh, buddy, buddy, buddy. Woo. That's all I can say. You want to be in the class. 559-726-1000. That's the phone number. You can call in, and it'll be 7:30 your time on the East Coast. So it's from 7:30 to 9, so 6:30 to 8 in Dallas. And the code to get on is 613-366-POUND. That's the call. So if you call in at 6:30, I'll be teaching class this Wednesday when I get back from here, inshallah. And if you call in at sometimes and nobody comes, it's because I'm either traveling or not having class that evening. That's all it is. The playback number in the event that you miss the class is 559-726-1099. And then you'll have to put a code in, so I think this class will be number 5. Because they go in numerical order. And if you want to go back and listen to the last 4, it'll be some Jumas in class. You call it 559-726-1099. Put in 1, put in 2, put in 3, 4. You'll get whatever comes up that's already pre-recorded there. And a couple of them are classes that's on those numbers. So I'll give you a number again. 559-726-1000. That's live. You can call in and hear Imam W.D. Muhammad's. Not Imam. Well, yeah. You're going to hear Imam W.D. Muhammad's commentary. But you're going to hear Imam Yahya Abdullah's class. Now, if you call in this Wednesday, this is what you're going to get. We're starting, John, on verse 21. Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 21. Now, what that means is, I have completed all of Al-Fatiha. Tajweed. All of it. It's on the table. I got a couple of them back there. That's about 12 CDs back there with Al-Fatiha. If you haven't listened to those, trust me, get it. I'm not making a commercial. I'm just saying you benefit from it. And my commentary, I don't have any. It's from Imam W.D. Muhammad. And let me show you something now. I brought a nice little gift. Can't give it to you.
What is the 61 number?
613-366-POUND. That's the access code. 613-366-POUND. That's 630 to 8 o'clock Central, which is 7:30 to 9 East Coast time. You see this?
Yes.
This is commentary of the Holy Quran by Imam W.D. Muhammad. This is what I ain't buy for me. Because this is a draft.
Can I go get it?
It's not finished yet. Wallace with WDM Publications is working on it. It's not finished yet. But this is the commentary I use when I'm making commentary. Right here from Ali. And he has the whole commentary of Al-Fatiha in here. Oh yeah. And Dr. Nasser Ahmed arranged it. Imam Qasim and I worked on it, edited. Imam Vernon Farid, a few of us worked on the editing part. So when I get the commentary in my class, right here, this is it. I don't have any text here, no commentary. I'm a student for real. I told Imam Raouf, he said, you weren't sleeping in the class with Imam. I said, no, I didn't sleep in any of those classes. I was awake for real. Ain't no joke now. Yes?
That's 7:30 p.m. or 8
now? P.m. That's in the evening. 7:30 p.m. in the evening. East Coast time. Okay? You all can call in, and I'm going to have you on mute so you can't say anything. I'm just going to teach the class. And if there are questions, I might unmute the phone and maybe take some questions during the class. Yes? I don't have a website yet. It's being designed. I don't have one up yet, but it's being designed. So we'll get that. But you can plug right in live to my classes. You come in live to the classes. And as I said, if the time doesn't permit you, you can go back on that playback number, the 1099, and put in 613-366-POUND and hit whatever reference number that is, 5, 6 or whatever it is, and then you can listen to it at your convenience. Yeah, Jab, how you doing, my friend? Assalamu alaikum. I don't want to put it up, but remind me before I leave to put it on the board. That's a very good idea, to put the number on the board. And so you all can participate in the class live on Wednesday. Yes, sir?
So can we get an advanced copy? I can run straight down the state with a copy of it.
No. It's one of your assistants. All right. No. I would love to give it to you, but I can't do it because I don't have the rights to sell it. I don't have, it's copyright, I don't have the rights. I'm just letting you all know, the information is there. And by the way, yeah, well, it's already done, we have it. It's 330 pages. There are 33 of these total. This is book one, volume one of 33. There are 32 more of these to come with 330 pages in each one.
Oh, man.
From our leader, Imam W.D. Muhammad.
Take me in.
Lord, commentary, tafsir of the Quran by Imam W.D. Muhammad. Now, shouldn't you have this in your hand?
Yes.
I shouldn't be the only one with this. Now, a few of us shouldn't be the only one with this. So, we press it. So, what I want you all to do, intelligently, respectfully, contact WDM Publications. Call my friend Wallace and say, Imam Yahya Abdullah showed us the book. Can you please tell us when it will be available? Now, you know how long I've been saying that. But there's some issues, but there, not of his own doing. He would love to make sure that all of us have it. I know him. He would gladly get it out so we can all have it. But the Imam left us in good shape with information. Now, I was a student for 33 years, Imam.
Yes, sir.
I'm reading through the commentary. I'm like, when did he say that? What lecture? Well, we couldn't be at all of the lectures. There's no way for us all to be at all these lectures. And you can't remember everything he taught us over 33 years. So I'm going through the book and I'm like, woo. I said, whoa. Now, I was there from 75 to 3 days before he passed. I worked with him very closely. In fact, he was my mentor. But he was more than my teacher. Some of y'all don't know, those who know me know. But he was my confidant. Well, I'll tell you what I mean by that now. He was a person that I could go talk to about whatever issues I had. And it stayed with him. And he would share with me things he would be going through. And he said, I'm sharing it with you so you can learn from that. That's the way we were. And when my enemies had my knives in my back, he told me how we're going to deal with them. It was his plan. He said, Yaka, here's the way we're going to handle them. I said, well, hi, Brother Imam. He said, every time you see me in public, he said, a big gathering, like at the convention or somewhere. He said, make your way up to me if you're not sitting in the front. He said, and when you come up, he said, and he did this a few times, we were laughing too, because I had a couple of knife, you know, they said, I looks could kill. I had a couple of killer looks sitting on the road. And they didn't get it. They're like, oh, there's Yaka. He's always going up here talking about it. He want to be seen. Man, this is what he told me to do. He said, make your way up to the front. He said, and then come talk to me. And he said, I'm going to grab you. He said, I'm going to give you a big bear hug. He said, it's going to kill him. Same thing, right? Okay, so sometimes we, you know. So one time we were at the convention, I came up. He said, he whispered in my ear, he said, y'all, can they dying out there right now? I said, yes, sir, man. That was his strategies. But that's how close we were. And he treated me and called me, considered me like one of his sons. I wasn't the only one. There was a few others. But he considered me as one of his sons. And I considered him as a father. Because it was more than just a leader, follower. He was our leader. He was my leader. But he was my friend. He was my friend, and he took pleasure in saying friend. He was a brother, but he was a friend, and he was a father figure, and he was a mentor. And the latter part of his life, we were business partners. Yeah, we were business partners. I'm wearing the partnership. All the brothers with the GBB, stand up. I like, come on, you know, there you go, come on. And if you have one and you don't have it on today, stand up. If you have one and you don't have it on, because I know some of you don't have them. Yeah, there you go, all you got. You gotta have it on today now. You got something there. That in every one of you all, we were business partners with Imam W.D. Muhammad. And he did it, so he wanted to see us make progress. That's what he wanted. Yes, Bilal? I'm sorry, Benjamin.
Can you elaborate on what, because a lot of people weren't there when we graduated,
they
saw how the Imam wrote that
piece. All right, before we get started, that's a good piece before we get started, because it was here.
Yeah.
In Washington, D.C.
Right, at the Saudi
Academy. Yeah, I went to school up there. The Saudi Academy in Washington, D.C. What year was that? 87, 88? I think it was back in 87.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah. How many of you were aware of that?
Most of you don't know.
Okay, I told you. And I told you many times. But what I didn't tell some of you, and Benjamin and I were talking about it earlier, why he wanted me to share this with you, when I graduated from the academy, and there were others with us in our association, Imam Yahya Abdullah in Orlando now, and a few other brothers there, but we were the top class. But when I graduated, Allah blessed me to be the valedictorian. Out of 126 students from around the country, I was the number one student. But I was a student. And the top student, they had told us this up front. Now, I wasn't doing this for that reason. But they said, whoever the top student is at the end of graduation, when the class is finished, the whole program, we will have that person speak at the ceremonies, at the embassy, the Saudi embassy. Well, that turned out to be me, by Allah's will. But what they did, the Saudis, wrote a speech. And they gave it to me. And I was supposed to recite this speech in the embassy on satellite that was being beamed to Saudi Arabia. And they had flew in scholars from around the world, Islamic scholars, for this occasion. It was the first time in the United States of America that it happened. And they flew in scholars from the Islamic world at the ceremony, at the embassy. So when they gave me the speech, now keep in mind, this was in colloquial Arabic. This was supposed to be Arabic now. This was speaking language. Now they taught me how to say it now. So now they're gonna give me a speech in all Arabic that I'm supposed to be some puppet to get up and read this prepared speech by them, beam to Saudi Arabia, selling out our leadership. I'm telling you.
And Imam was there.
I was so livid. I was so upset. I went to one of the organizers and I told him, I said, do you see this speech? You actually expect me to get up and read this? And I'm going to tell you what was in it that disturbed me. It said in Arabic, I learned Islam for the first time when I came to this program. That is crazy. It was an insult too. I've been a Muslim since 1973. I'm sorry, not Arabic. I learned Islam for the first time. Not Arabic, I said Arabic. No, I learned Islam for the first time. I knew Arabic when I went in there. I was studying Arabic since 1976. And, but what was insulting was the statement, I learned Islam for the first time since I came here to this program. Now, that was major implications. And this was being beamed to Saudi Arabia. So I was supposed to get up as one of Imam Muhammad's top students and insult all of us and sell us out so that the people overseas could hear that they were the ones who was teaching us real Islam. And I told Imam Muhammad when he came to Washington at the Willard Hotel, I'll never forget, we were at the Willard Hotel the day of graduation. And I had told one of the organizers, I said, you see this speech? You actually think that I'm going to get up? And I told him, Dr. Khalil, I told him, I said, you actually think I'm going to get up and say this? I said, man, I'm not doing that. He read it. Good. This is terrible. I said, yeah, it is terrible. And I'm not going to read this terrible speech. See, I wasn't like some of our brothers. They were just so happy to be around them. They are brothers. I didn't worship any of them. Imam Muhammad was my leader. Still is. So when I get to the Willard Hotel, you all know where the Willard Hotel is? All right, so you already know. So we downtown at this exclusive hotel. Imam Muhammad comes in for the big graduation. He was there. Imam came in. Imam, this is late. So we sitting in the lobby. So I tell Imam W. Muhammad, I said, brother Imam, they want me to read this speech. I'm not doing it. So he said, nah, the Imam was strategic. He said, well, Imam Yahya, sometimes you have to go with the flow. I said, yes, sir, brother man. I know that, but I can't flow with this one. He said, let me see it. So I gave it to him. All Arabic. Didn't translate any of it, because he knew Arabic. I just handed him the speech in Arabic. He looked at it, the same problem I had. He had. He said, what? You can't say this. I said, you know, I'm all upset. You know, that's right, I ain't doing it. He said, no, wait a minute now. Calm down. He said, let's change it. This is about an hour or so before the graduation. We at the Willard Hotel. He said, let's change it. So he takes his pen out, go through the Arabic, mark it up, change it. Okay, take this word out, put this word in. Take this word out, put this word in. Take this whole sentence out, put this sentence in. He changed it. But what I'm gonna tell you, he was so humble, he didn't change the top part of the speech. Now at the top was all the accolades for the king, for the scholars. Imam Muhammad's name was nowhere in it. He didn't put his name in it, but I did. I did. Imam didn't put his name in this speech. So when he finished it, he gave it back to me. It was I read what he wrote. He said, this is okay. This is, I said, oh yeah, this is good. What he changed was, he said, my knowledge of Arabic has been enhanced for this program. He said, and I have learned some things about the religion that I was not aware of. That's how he changed it. But he didn't put any nonsense. He scratched out the nonsense about I learned Islam for the first time. So I come to the podium for the graduation. And you know how they did things with the Saudi embassy. Everything is top flight. Everything. So the big artist, first thing out of my mouth, they call up the sheikh. We will now have our top student of this program, our valedictorian, Imam Yahya Abdullah, who will give us the class closing speech. So they thinking, it's their speech. But I never told them Imam Muhammad changed it. So I get up, first thing out of my mouth after Bismillah, Summum Imam Miwaritudin Muhammad. Shoo! Got quiet. But this is what goes across the satellite. Yeah. Now, what did I just say? He knows what I just said. I said, greetings to my Imam, W.D. Muhammad. And I said it in there. And the Imam looked at me with that big smile on his face, nodding like that. That's my boy. And when I said that, summum inami waridudin, and I emphasized like that, because they taught you how to make the intonations and nuances in the language. Summum inami waridudin Muhammad. Please got quiet. That's my Imam right there sitting in the audience. Now y'all cut the nonsense out. And then I went on with the speech. Now, while I was giving the speech, you know how we say, Allahu Akbar, this is not how they show their approval now. I'm speaking, they say, So I'm like, what's all that noise? I said, no, I ain't messing up. I got this. I know I ain't messing up. This was their way of showing approval. So, when I finished the speech, the person who wrote it, who was my professor, the sheikh, he was standing at the edge of the stage, and I'll tell you this, I'm done with this. He was standing at the edge of the stage where you come off the podium. So I walked off the stage, I walked off the podium, and when I came down, he says to me, the sheikh, who was the one who wrote this, from Saudi Arabia, one of our professors, he says, Imam Yahya. I says, Naam, Ya Ustad. Yes, O Professor. He looked me right in the eye. He says, Mumtaz. Mumtaz. I mean, excellent. Yeah, Mumtaz. Excellent. Mumtaz. And I said, Shukran. Thank you, Emma. And I walked off. What was he saying? He was saying, now I know I wrote this for you. But that speech you just gave wasn't what I wrote. But I respect you.
Alhamdulillah.
For changing it. For standing up for what you say you believe. And I respect you for supporting your leader. And you did an excellent job. So, Mumtaz.
Oh, Akbar.
Yeah. Now, I told him, Benham, I said, it cost me my scholarship. And yeah. Imam Muhammad been in South University 4 years, all expenses paid. But that's all right. Didn't need to go. Because one of the benefits from going to that program was if you concluded it and finished it successfully, was all expenses, buddy, ma'am, paid. 4-year degree program. graduate of Imam Muhammad bin Saud University in Medina. I had the documents. I have it to this day. My acceptance, my papers, my certificate, my scholarship. I have it all. So I made arrangements with my family. I was going to do 6 months at a time. 6 months in Saudi, 6 months in the States, 6 months in Saudi, 6 months in the States. So I set everything up. So I go to them, I call them up. I'm ready to do my first 6 months. Guess what they told me? they said to me, but they did it nicely. They says, like this. Imam Yahya, you have no need for this program.
Yeah, I don't need it for the program. It's 4 years. I've only been up here 3 months. I want the program. I earned it.
Right. You told me at the end of it, I would have a scholarship, and they gave it to me.
I had it in hand.
I'm just ready to execute it. Yeah, amen. You have no need. And I argued to no avail, man.
They wouldn't give it to you. I told him, I said, right now, they don't want me to come for the program. You gave me a scholarship, and I told him I don't need it. He said, you don't.
He said, you don't need it. He said, but you know why they told you that, don't you? I said, I have an idea. He said, they couldn't control you. They couldn't manipulate you. And they couldn't tell you what to do. He said, when you gave that speech in that embassy, that was it. He said, this one we cannot control. He's 110% with Imam W.D. Muhammad. That's right. What he said. They couldn't flip me. And now that gives me my segue to the Taleem. Why should they be able to flip any of us?
That's right.
Our history. The people behind us. The people in the Nation of Islam, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm and Sister Clara and all those pioneers that was in this city that built Masjid Muhammad number 50 from the ground up in Washington, D.C., Temple number 4, Detroit, Chicago, Motor City, Chicken Land, Milwaukee, where the ideas were milled and walked with. You know what I'm saying? You walk through the mill and grind the ideas. He said, and the fourth step was the Capitol. He said, we're going to the Capitol. Well, we were at the Capitol Friday for Jumu'ah prayer. First from our community, our history, we gave the Jumu'ah prayer from the Capitol live. Around the country, they heard it. Alhamdulillah. So why should they be able to flip any of us? And any of you all were in there, the majority of the brothers who came for the Jumu'ah Friday, I told them very respectfully.
Oh, yes.
I said to them, listen, we are natives to this country. When you come here, you respect us like we would respect you if we're in your country. We are Muslims in one international ummah, but we are not looking for you to tell us what to do. No more should you be looking for us to tell you what to do in your land. Everybody respect each other. That's all. You just respect each other. And but some of us, we don't think we real Muslims unless we looking like one of them, talking like one of them, eating like one of them, because we don't value ourselves, we have no confidence in self-identity. Those have been historical problems for us as African Americans.
Check beer.
Allah Akbar. So we can become Muslims. We can become Muslims without being an Arab. We can become, well, suppose all the Muslims be Arabs. What about everybody else? Nobody, all the Muslims are Arabs. This is ridiculous. All the Muslims are Pakistani. This is ridiculous. All of them are Malaysian. All the Muslims are Indonesian or African American. This is ridiculous. So, but here's my question I always ask the brothers, especially when I go to Philly. I say, I have a question. Does anybody want to be you?
No.
Man, come on, man. You want me to be you? Well, be me. You want me to copy you or copy me? See, that's when you have your own self, sense of self. And your sense of, you ask those kind of questions. That why do you want me to follow you all the time? How many of y'all grew up in the hood? Boy, no, you shouldn't be in the hood, mine. We grew up in the hood. Now, listen. When we were growing up in the hood, those of us who got respect were those of us who led instead of followed. Right? You're respected if you led. You're the leader. You're following everybody. Nobody got respect for following everybody. So why would you give up even hood mentality when you become a Muslim? You knew better than that when you were in the hood. This is ridiculous. So we don't have to copy anybody. And listen, I'm not criticizing them. Allah knows I don't. We love them. My criticism, and I don't even want to say it's a criticism, it's more of a critique.
Right.
It's a critique of our behavior and our mentality.
Right. Right.
I'm not blaming them. I look at us and say, come on, brother, come on, sister. Allah made you unique. You are unique, individually unique, individually gifted, individually talented, individually skilled, males. Allah did that. Now, why are you going to give that up and take on someone else's personality, costumes, customs, traditions? And since you brought this up, then, about this program up in D.C., let me tell you one last thing, and I'm going to get on to the subject, because I have a time limit on myself. We were in class, and we had our brothers from Philly, used to show up. I used to call them the Thobe brothers, T-H-O-B-E, the Thobe brothers. They show up every day with a Thobe on. Now, there's nothing wrong with a Thobe as long as you're wearing it at home. Or in Saudi Arabia in the desert. But we were in Alexandria, Virginia. At a high-end hotel where we stayed. And the program was at that hotel, and then they had another place we would go for the general lecture. And these brothers would just show up in class to be showing off. They come in all wrapped all up. So me and the brother, hey man, come on man, y'all African American, this is embarrassing. Where you going? This is what I would tell them, they're our brothers. Oh, you one of them Warf D Knights. I said, okay, you call me whatever you want to call me. But here was the odd thing about the whole thing. Every day the professor showed up from Saudi Arabia, he dressed like this. The black man show up, he dressed like he in the desert. One day, I lost my witness. I don't know what made these brothers do this. They came to class, had kifaya from Saudi Arabia. Now, I don't know where they got it from. I know. They had on the dress of the Saudis. There's about two or three of them. They sat right up front of the class. So, of course, when they come in, me and Ma'am Hatham, I meet a lot of Orlando, Florida, he's the ma'am down there. We looked at them, and I opened my mouth as always. I said, hey, man, what's wrong with y'all? Why y'all got on these Saudi clothes, bro? You ain't no Saudi. You will fit it.
But where's Saudi?
That's from Philadelphia. I said, man, y'all from Philly, man. Why y'all just walk shit up? You tell us what. Just be shit up. I don't care. But you look silly. That's what I told you. You look silly from Philly. Well, they don't pay me no mind. They don't pay me no mind. The professor walks in, but he don't see him. His back is like this. So he starts writing a lesson on the board. So he don't see these brothers. The Saudi professor. He's writing a lesson on the board. So when he finished with the day's lesson, he turns around. He said to him, there's about three. He said, hey, my mother, you understand? Hel antum Saudiya? You know what I just said. Are you all Saudis? Now they had learned a few words in Arabic. La. He said, thumma. Then, limada, then why are you labisaku wearing our dress? That's what he said to him. And they tried to explain it. He said, you are insulting me. Those are not your clothes. Those are my clothes. Those are our cultural dress. And you are insulting us when you show up in class like this. In other words, he had to be respectful. But really what he was saying was, he wanted to use the N-word. But he blasted him. He said, now me, and he never hops. Listen, I'm telling you, no joke. I was fought, my stomach was hurting so bad. I had cramps. I was laughing so hard.
I was trying to tell him.
Oh, well, y'all gotta know what he's talking about. Son, he's a warthite, wardenite. Man, my stomach, you know, I had knots in my stomach. I was falling out the seat laughing. Cause their own man that they were trying to impress and be like, told them, take them off. And he told them, don't you ever come to my class again with my clothes on. And he went on to educate them. He said, those clothes are for our environment. Those clothes are for the culture. Those clothes are for the tradition. And he told them, he said, when you come to my class again, you wear your American dress. That's what he told them. And then he went to explain, because you know his brother be hollering about, brother, brother, this the Sunnah. Really? Well, Abu Lahab wore those clothes. You know what that is, the father of man, right? Abu Jahl wore those clothes. You know what that is, yeah? Father of ignorance. All the ignorant Arabs before al-Islam dressed like that. So how is it Sunnah if they were dressing like that before al-Islam? This is cultural dress. Now let me tell you what I do and what I did when I went to Saudi Arabia, and you should do if you go in the summertime. You can't wear this. It's too hot. How many Hajjis are here? Ooh, look at the numbers. Can you walk around in the desert with these clothes on? You have to come out of this stuff. And you have to wrap your head with the kifaya. Susan don't want to cover up. You better cover your head or you will have a heat stroke. And they explained to us the way to throw the jalabib because it allows for the circulation of air underneath the fold. Where if you just have on these pants, you sweat and the heat gets you. So it's a protection against the environment. Well, if you're in Philadelphia and it's 10 degrees below, what you doing with a robe on? And some sandals, this is insanity. Could you imagine dressing like that in Alaska? This is craziness. So their dress, and he was educating these brothers, the dress comes from the culture, and it's cultural dress. And Muhammad the Prophet, prayers and peace be upon him, he told the Arabs of his day, he said, when you go among other people, take care not to change their culture. Why they don't tell you that idea? That's how he heard. It's there. He said, take care. He said, and speak in the language of the people. Not necessarily dumb, but speak in a language they understand. He said, don't upset. He said, just make sure their traditions, culture, customs, whatever, is not against Islam. But don't try to change them. All right? So now that takes us to our subject. A better future is our destiny. So you want to know what our destiny? A better future. That's what you all are working on here. With the Ali Khan, Imam Ali Khan Islamic Center, you're working for a better future, a better future. And the efforts to build massages, to build schools. Now, let's not forget our schools. Someone was asking me, I think it was Imam Hamza. Yeah, it was Imam Hamza. When I came here Thursday, he was asking me, what are the state of our community? How do I see our community? Because I travel throughout the community. From one end of the country to the other, alhamdulillah. And I can tell you the community is in good shape. Community is growing in the knowledge of the religion. People are studying the Quran, memorizing, learning it, the language of Muhammad the Prophet, the language of the Imam. We have so many young, achieving, outstanding youth in these top Ivy League schools, Harvard, Yale, NYU, Stanford. Oh yeah! Some of them working right up here on the Capitol that you don't even know about, advising the president, that's from our community that you don't even know about, that I'm aware of. Harvard grads in the legal department up here in Washington, D.C., that advises the president from our community. Their fathers, I know them, and I won't name them. Their fathers, I know their fathers. They're very prominent in our community, but their children have excelled and we have others. So the community is in good shape. But here's the concern where we need to do better.
Yes.
We don't have the strong schools like we used to, the Claremont schools. Now, we don't have the resources to establish the school through a weekend school. If you can't do a weekend school, do an after-school program where somebody can volunteer to teach these children when they get out of private, these public schools. Just the Quran, the understanding of the Quran, the knowledge, and also the language of Imam Muhammad. Make sure they get that. In the life of our Prophet, the basics. Okay, make sure they get that. So you may not have the money, but if you got any facilities, you should have a school, some kind of educational program for our youth. So that's what I see as our weakness, as our weak points. Around the country, we don't have as many schools, education institutions as we used to have. Now, we can do something about it. We can change it, as I said. The economy hit everybody, impacted everybody. That's okay, but this is a facility here, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And you got mosque in every place, so you don't have to go, some city sister sent out an email, from Bermuda. And she sent the email around, we shouldn't have a school in a masjid. But she's a young lady. I'm like, she is crazy. And she's trying to tell them to have a mid, well, she's from America, went over there. She's not from there. She took her crazy mind over there. They've had a school for I don't know how long. My mother-in-law is the director over there in Bermuda. And my wife is from Bermuda. They've had a prestige school. Now look, they have a facility. Imam W. Marvin gave them the money to buy it. About 100,000 square feet, four stories up in the heart of Hamilton, Bermuda. You've been there, it's beautiful, isn't it? Gorgeous property worth $3.5-4 million. Where else would you put the school? And she's running around telling we need to raise $1 million. I said $1 million in Bermuda won't even buy you a decent house. It won't.
That's right.
No, it won't. You might have 1,100, 1,200 square feet if you have $1 million in Bermuda. You'd be living in the, now they don't have a hood, but what they would call would be the hood is where you'd be living in for $1 million. It don't go far in Bermuda. I'm telling you. So use the facilities we have to educate these young people, our youth, so because we're getting up in age. I don't say we're getting old, we're getting up in age. And we want to leave them behind us to carry, like your sons are doing, like Sharif and others, and your, these wonderful young brothers that are carrying the mantle forward. And I heard him lead the prayer the other night. He is good. But we want more Sharifs and Jamal. We want more of them and Bijan. We want more of these young people. But that's our responsibility now. That's not theirs. They can work with what we give them, what we need them. So let's not go to sleep and act like we need $1 million to teach the Quran. I lived in Africa for 5 months. They teach the Quran under the tree because they're out in the village. They don't say, oh brother, we have to have $1 million before school. They say, look, get those children, come up under this tree, sit down. And they sit on little wooden benches they made under the tree. And they teach the Quran under the tree. I was out in the village. Now they have schools in the city. Of course, big institutions. So don't think Africa's all jungle now. You better get off that National Geographic page. And they wanted to take me on a safari. You heard me talking about that before, right? I said, man, I don't want to go on no safari. I saw that on TV. I want to see the bank. I want to see the grocery stores.
That's right.
I want to see the institutions of high learning. I want to see the cars. They got more Mercedes-Benz than we ever did. So they took me to the banks. They took me to the higher institutional learning. They took me to the government offices. Our brothers are doing it just like we do it every place else. And they're run by Africans. So I ain't want to see no lions, no elephants, none of that crazy stuff they show us on TV. And by the way, I didn't see Tarzan. Hollywood!
Hollywood.
And I got on a plane.
flown by Africans in Kenya, Kenyan Airways. And I checked when I walked through, I looked in the cockpit to make sure it was some Kenyans in their cockpit. It wouldn't bother me if it was somebody else. But I just checked, so when I got back to the States, I wanted to make sure I had the validation that it was some African pilots flying the plane. So when I stuck my head in, I said, Assalamu alaikum. They said, Wa alaikum assalam. I said, Habari. They said, Ibsuri. You all know what I just said, dude. Kiswahili. Habari gani. Yeah, there you go, Dawu. I learned a few words when I was over there. So they were Africans. The stewardess on the plane were all Africans, and the plane took off very well, and it didn't crash. I'm here. And they flew the plane very well, so we got our African brothers flying planes, so you can get out of that National Geographic stuff about some jungle. But they had schools under the tree for those who were in the villages of Shinyanga, because I went to the villages of Shinyanga, which is nothing but villages and trees. And I didn't see these prestigious institutions out in the village. They were just out under the tree learning. And those who could make it to some schools, they had a few schools.
I'm right under it.
The children were going to the schools, but that did not stop them from teaching the Quran. Now we have facilities. We have this facility. Mm-hmm. We have facilities all over this country. And everywhere I go, I say, please, sake of our future, have at least a weekend school.
Okay, no problem.
And don't charge the parents anything. Don't charge the students anything. Volunteer. Some of you all who wait in the grandma mic, that's your opportunity. teach the people who don't know. Teach the new ones. You don't have to come up and give a khutbah in the Juma. Teach those young brothers. Teach those young sisters. You know Arabic? If you know more than they do, then you're qualified to share with them. So you go to the imam, but imam, I'd like to start a class. I'd like to volunteer my time and help our young people learn the Quran, learn al-Islam, learn the life of our prophet, which is part of al-Islam, learn the language of my... I want to volunteer. And we put the program together on Sunday and just tell the young people, no matter if you have two show up. First week, two show up. Next week, the same two show up. Sit at the table and educate them. And let them Twitter. Tell them, say, tweet your friends. Facebook your friends. And tell them they need to be at the class. Email your friends. Huh? They got all this technology? Yeah! Tell them, Skype your friends. Get on an iPad and send your friends the message. They got it? Text them. Why you not in class? Just send the text out. Beep. Why you out here? Where you at, bro? Come on, man. Get to the class. Sister, get over here. What's happening? See, use that for positive. That's how you do it. And you can start this, put the program together. You can start this next week. How much does it cost to do it? Zero. Zero. You have the facilities already. There's a blackboard right there. There's a table right there. Some chairs right here. You have a school. You just need to get the students in it and get the teachers to volunteer. And when you volunteer, don't even ask for gas. Well, y'all gonna give me some gas money. I already told you to volunteer. You get more barakah, blessings, than you would for gas money. You know why I paid my way to come here and stand with my brother for 4 or 5 days here? Because they're the barakah, blessings from God. And because Imam Ali Khan was my friend too, my dear brother. And all I wanted to do was, what can I do in a small way to help out? So I told Sister Ophelia, she said, we don't need to send you no tickets. I said, no. Get my own ticket. She said, what about hotel accommodation? I said, no. I got that taken care of. So it didn't cost you anything to get me here. Allahu Akbar. Thank God for that. Now, if I can fly from way to Dallas to come to D.C. for a worthy cause, you can't tell me you can't drive from across town to come here on the weekend for a worthy cause to teach our children.
Go ahead.
Unacceptable. Yeah, you can't tell me that. I won't accept that. And you retired from school. You retired. You tell, oh, I retired from the school. Well, you haven't retired from that as long. Get at the masjid and teach somebody. Bring your teaching skills to the community now. And we'll put together the curriculum. If you don't know what to do, the ma'am will do that. We have people can put together the curriculum and say, teach this curriculum to our children. That's our weakness in our community. Business is not our weakness. I'm telling you that right now. We have so many business brothers and sisters all over this country making money. Serious money. That's a nice segue into this. I'm going to show you one of them. Show you one. See this? Black Enterprise magazine. January edition. See this? Okay, this is not our magazine. Page 58. Michael Rashid. Used to be the imam in Baltimore, Maryland. 1978 was my minister in the Nation of Islam, Jacksonville, Florida. This is who I came in on in 1973, MBA from Harvard in the Nation of Islam, bachelor's from USC in the Nation of Islam, MBA from Harvard in finance, runs Keystone Mercy, Mirror Health Mercy right now on the East Coast, Philadelphia. Call him a power player. Page 58, did $4 billion with a B in 2010 and growing. Father of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, student of Imam W. D. Muhammad, teacher of Imam Yahya Abdullah, former Imam in Baltimore, Masjid. Running it. CEO! Abra! And I don't know nobody else in the country bigger than him now. Y'all do let me know so I can advertise him or her too. But this is the biggest one we got right now. And he's asking for vendors. They did $30 million worth of business with minority vendors. He wants to triple it this year. $90 million. So he told me, whenever I go to Philly, this is who I stay with. This is my man. This is my business partner. Business associate. Oh, yeah. Well, I ain't crazy. I do suits, man, but I want to know how to get some of this. And he's working with me now. He told me how to do it. He's looking for people who are certified business people. I can give you the name of the person. He put the guy directly in contact with me. The man called me up. He said, Michael, my CEO, told me to call you. I said, I'm sure he did. He said, he told me, give Yahya whatever he wants. I said, send me the list of everything you all purchase. I want to know that if I don't have it, I go around the country. I'm going to mention it to our brothers and sisters. So he sent me the list. Janitorial. Real estate, furniture, computers, printing and graphics, office supplies. So if you have a relationship with someone with these items or yourself in that business, all you need to do is contact me. I will put you in contact with Ron Baldwin, who is his purchasing agent that's in charge, and I will tell Michael Rashid, Mike, brother so-and-so-and-so gonna be sending the stuff up. Mike, sister so-and-so-and-so gonna send something. Gonna say send it right on up here. He wants to increase it to $90 million worth of business among us. Not just Allahu Akbar. Not just Muslims, but African American. So you have an opportunity if you don't have it, but this your brother. I'm your brother. We here. So you go and say, oh, hey, look, man, you got that You got a janitorial thing? Are you pretty good? You got your HUD, your historic underutilized business? You got your all your certifications from the region and the state? Well, we hook up. I can get you some contracts, but I need a piece. I need a piece. Here's how we're going to do this. We need a partnership. And we plug in to get some of that business. We're doing well. Oh, this is serious business. There he is. $4 billion in 2010. And growing. Allah is blessing.
Allah.
A better future is our destiny. Now, where am I getting that from? Allah says in the Quran, chapter 93, which is chapter Duha, verse 4, وَلَا الْآخِرْتُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. I mentioned this yesterday.
And the future will be better for you than the present. That's what God tells us. And it's in the chapter of Duha when the prophet, in fact, I have it right here, he was struggling. Was he struggling? Oh, yes, he did. Having a hard time. And Allah revealed this to him. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In God's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. What duha by the glorious morning light? What layli idha sajja, and by the night when it is quiet? Ma wada'aka rabbuka wa ma qala. Thy guardian Lord, O Muhammad, has not forsaken thee, nor is he displeased with you. Wal al-akhiratu khayrun laka, singular, min al-ula. And the future for you, O Muhammad, will be better than your present circumstances. But that appeals to us. That's why I said the singular. Wal al-akhiratu. Well, that akhiratu khayrun laka. So when I read this, Allah is addressing me personally, as an individual. He addresses us as an ummah, but he wants us to know each, every one of us, males and females. Just like when the prophet, as an individual, was struggling in human struggles as a human being, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, God's prayers and peace be upon him. Each of us, individually, will have our challenges, our struggles, our own jihad. That's why I call that. We will all have our own jihad. But when we are having these challenges and these struggles personally, because each of us have to be tested.
Right.
And let me take it to another level. Each one of us have to be purged. For paradise. So don't look at your struggles all the time as a bad thing. Allah is purging you for a better future in the destiny. And when we were with Rafi, and the brother told me about somebody in the hospital sick, I told him, I said, listen, do you know what the prophet said? And I shared this with Imam Taleem Sharif when he went to visit the sister in the hospital. I said, share with her and her family. He told me what the prophet said. Illness, sickness is Allah's way of removing sins from his servant. Woo. Is that a bad thing? Now, don't be asking to get sick, but is that a bad thing? When it happens, that's Allah's mercy to you. And the longer you got to go through it, that's Allah's mercy to you. Knocking down your sins. Washing them off because he's so merciful. He wants you in paradise. But you can't come in dirty. So he said, okay, my servant here been messing up a little bit. So I need to clean him up because I love him. I need to clean her up because I love her. I created her. And I love her. And I need to clean her up. She ain't gonna like the way I'm gonna do it, but I gotta get her ready for the destiny.
That's right.
So I'm gonna knock her down with cancer. I'm gonna knock him down with prostate. I'm gonna knock her down with heart trouble. They ain't gonna like it. I'm gonna knock them down with high blood. They're gonna be laid up. Liver problem, kidney problem, heart problem, diabetes, whatever. Knock them down. But I'm not knocking them down to knock them down. I'm knocking them down to get them out.
Yes.
I'm knocking them down to clean them up because I want them in the destiny. And they can't come in to Dar es Salaam, the home of peace. Dirty. Can't come in like that, but they don't know how to clean it up. If they did, they wouldn't be messing up. So I'm going to help them out with my angels of mercy. I'm going to send them illness. And the illness is going to purge them. They're going to lay up there. And sins gonna fall off. And some of them I'm gonna stand back up on their feet. And others of them, once I clean them up, I can't let him get back up because he gonna mess up again. I can't let her get back up. She gonna mess up again. So I'm gonna clean him up, clean her up,
and I'm going to bring them to me. And I'm going to say, Udu ila enter into Jannah. Come on in here. You are clean now. Meet Allah Akbar. Meet your brothers and sisters who were waiting on you long before. And I know you didn't like the way I got you here. But I had to get you here because I love you. But you're here now. Go on in there and enjoy the blessings of paradise. Minerula. And the future is better for you.
Right.
And you.
Right.
And you. And you. And you. And you. And you. And me. Individually. Is better for you than the present situations. And if you don't get that better life in this life, guaranteed you're going to have it in the destiny. The final akhirah. You're going to have it in the next life. You're going to have it in the hereafter. You may have had all these goals and dreams and visions and things you want to do.
That's right.
And you pass out of this life. You never got it done.
Right.
You leave here, you'll be able to do it over there.
Mm.
Oh, yeah. And I'm going to tell you something else the Imam shared with us. And you heard me say this before. He said, everybody born that Allah, out of his will, brought into existence is blessed because you will never die. Well, I went to a janazah yesterday. Okay. That's the body you put away. Soul is still alive. How do we know? Allah says, speak not of my servants, they're alive, but you can't perceive how they live. Because there's a barrier, just like between the two waters. There's a barrier where there's salt water don't overrun the sweet water. And they respect each other's space. So I have set up a barrier between this world and the next world. So they don't overrun each other. So you can't jump across the hereafter to check things out, then jump back over here. Well, they can't come from over there, over here, to tell you what's over there. I have a barrier. And the barrier of that world has to stay there. And the barrier of this world has to stay there. And you on this side have to have faith on that side. I got a barrier that shall not be transgressed. So you ain't got no evidence of going to paradise. I don't have evidence. And you got to have faith. You have to have faith. And one day, you're going to go to the threshold and you will see, as God said in the Quran, your loved ones. You'll see your mothers that have passed on. The fathers that have passed on. Yeah, Imam W.D. Muhammad be standing there welcoming you. Hey, come on, brother. Come on, sister. I missed you. We've been having fun over here. Welcome, glad to have you. He'll be waiting for you. Every one of us that he can recognize. And everyone. And you be, and even if you don't recognize, you're going to look for him. Where's Imam W.D. Muhammad?
Damn.
I want to tell him I'm here. They'll be there. All the brothers that have passed on, you will see them again. All the sisters that have, all the sisters that have passed on, you'll see them again. The children that have passed on, you'll see your son again. They're over there. And their life, a better future, is our destiny. They're already experiencing it. And they all are saying this. I could use my imagination. I know what all of them say. Woo! I wish I could go back over there and tell them. Nobody came and told you, did they? You had to believe, didn't you?
That's right.
Said, yeah, that's true. Well, they're going to have the same faith. You can't go back in time. You can't go back and, hey, man, put that weed down, right? You can't come back and tell them. Girl, what you doing in there? Look at your, get out of there. Can't come back and tell them. They got to have the same faith that you had to get over here. But the better future is our destiny. Now, I took you way over there. Let me finish what the Imam said. He said, Allah blessed him, and it's in the Quran, to understand something about life and death in the next life.
He said, God bless me to understand this. That when he folds up paradise, when he folds up paradise, I didn't say this life, when paradise is finished, and he folds it up, he said, Allah is going to take the souls that were purified in paradise, recreate new matter, recreate new physical forms. Take all the soul that he purified in paradise, deposit each one of us in new bodies. He said it'll be like no bodies we've seen before. He said in those forms we'll experience no illness, no back pain, no arthritis. They won't have any problems. He said that's what Allah blessed me to see and understand, that he's going to create a new physical reality. And deposit our souls that came out of paradise into those new physical realities. And we will live and exist on a higher level than anything we could imagine right now. Oh, that's beautiful. So what you worry about? Don't worry about anything. Future is better for you personally as an individual. And always remember that, no matter what you're going through. You remember this verse in the Quran. Allah says, وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. I ain't got no money right now. وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. My wife ran off. وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. This sorry dude of a husband I have, ain't sent no child support, I won't pay that. وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. The future will be better for me than my present circumstances. They cut back on the government job, fired me, and laid me off, and they caught me off guard. Well, I could have took care of me, kept me in a hula. Future better for you than the present. Keep that in mind. Well, I saw for you, Atika, Rabbu Kafatorda. And very soon, this is what Allah told the Prophet. Verse 5. And very soon will our Lord give you, O Muhammad. But it's in the singular. Well, it's all for your teeth. And very soon will our Lord give you and you and you and you and you and you and me what shall please you. Soon, lasofa means soon. It's going to come and it'll be like that. God is going to give you what will sell your soul. He'll give you what will sell your soul in time. And the next chapter, 94, 5, and 8, and we all know this so well. Oh my goodness. Y'all all right?
Yes.
Can I have a... like 5 or 10 more minutes? Okay. No, I won't have much time. We have a market back there. And I want to say you something. I can't get the market. And the brother has some t-shirts and some other artwork back there. Support them. Don't just buy stuff from me. Support them. In fact, I'd like to see other vendors. Because I bring everybody back there when you have more, when you have a variety of stuff. So Sharif has his excellent artwork and cards and t-shirts, and so support that also. Verse 5. فَإِنَّمَا عَلَى أُسْرِ يُسْرًا. We all know this, right? إِنَّمَا عَلَى أُسْرِ يُسْرًا. So verily with every difficulty, there is relief. Surely with. Ma'a means with. Didn't say ba'da. There you go, Imam Ali. Ba'da means after. Allah could have said ba'da. He says ma'a. With it. That with the trouble comes the ease. Comes with it. You just gotta wait. You experiencing the trouble. But you forgetting the ease is there in the trouble. You just gotta
unto the ease of peace. And Muhammad the Prophet, prayers and peace be upon him, he said, paradise is veiled by hardship and struggle. Hell is veiled by ease and delights. And that's what the prophet said, that's what I mean. I'm giving you the word of our prophet so we can have our perspectives changed. Hardship is the veil of paradise. Ease is the veil of hell. So when you are struggling and struggling, that's just a veil. If you can move the veil, get past the veil of hardship, you're going to see paradise on the other side. In this life, you'll get a slice of it, a piece of it here. Well, how do you know that? Allah says when you show up in paradise. If you had some of it here, you're going to say, well, this is similar to what we had before. Woo! Just to tell us something. Listen carefully. See, Allah's wisdom is deep. And he has so many ways of conveying the message. So he tells us in the book that when you get over there, we will say, why, this is similar. Now, look, we're talking about paradise.
Teacher,
why, this is similar to what I had before. What is he telling us? Get you some here. So you will recognize it when you get there. Brother. You know I'm going that way.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You must not have any of this dunya. whoa, hold up. Say, now I hear what you're saying. But I have read in the Quran, chapter, write it down, 28, verse 77. Wabtaghi fima attaqullahu dar akhirah wala tansa. Listen to the language. Nasibu tap, 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 tap. And do not wala tansa nasibu tap. And do not wala tansa nasibu tap. Minute dunya. Don't forget and don't neglect, as Imam Muhammad changed it, and don't neglect your share of the minute dunya, of the dunya. So who are you telling me that I can't have no dunya? And dunya is that world out there. And to make the distinction, Allah says, وَتَّقِ فِي مَا أَتَّقَ اللَّهِ دَارُ الْآخِرَةِ. So there's no confusing dunya with akhirah. No confusion.
That's
right. Seek whatever way you can to get in. Help with the Ali Khan Islamic Center. That may be your route. Doing dawah might be your route. Imam might be your route. Taking care of the masjid might be the way in. Prison chaplaincy might be the way in. Working in business and donating money might be your way in. Teaching in the school might be your way in. Taking care of your children, sister, might be your way in. Why? Prophet Muhammad said paradise lies at the feet of the mother.
Yeah.
Taking care of your children might be your way in. Taking care of your husband might be your way in if you don't have any children. Treating him like he deserves to be treated and not like a piece of garbage might be your way. I don't know y'all, so I don't know who's doing that. They must be doing it because it came out of my mouth. And we know how it goes. We just open up, say, Bismillah, and Allah takes over. He said, okay, I need you to say this because Sister So-and-so stomping that brother in the head, and he was trying to, he was arguing with all the way over here to the masjid. Shut up, I'm going to the Taleem. Get quiet. Hey, what's wrong with you, Owen? Somebody will come up and say, brother, man, how you know that? I'm like, I don't know anything. God gave you that. I don't know what you're going through. But if it jumped out my mouth, that would help somebody. What a tense nasib cat. Don't forget your share. Now that was being revealed to a rich man. Pharaoh that had so much wealth, he couldn't carry it all. He was Warren Buffett rich. He was Bill Gates rich. He was Carlos Slim rich. He had so much wealth that it took hundreds of men to help him carry the keys to the chest. But he was reminded, all that ain't yours. Don't you know I say don't let the wealth make a circuit just among a few of you? It should circulate among everybody. And they're going to criticize President Obama. He's talking about wealth redistribution. Allahu Akbar! Finally, somebody get it. That you caroons in the Republican Party, you got enough keys, millions of acres of land, and we can't find a block for a mess yet, because you hard and all, you just got all this land. You ain't find nothing. You ain't getting none of this. So Allah tells the rich man, hey, buddy, you only have a share. It's not all yours. And what did Warren Buffett say?
With the yellow
stripes. Well, he gave away his money to the Bill Gates Foundation. I saw the interview. They asked him, because he was starving. He gave away $37 billion. They questioned Mr. Buffett. He said, I gave it away because I'm trying to get into paradise. He said, I'm trying to make it to heaven. Now listen to that. Here's a rich man. The second wealthiest, Forbes listed. He said, I gave it away. I don't need it. I can't take it with me. I made it. I'm doing well with the cat that I need, the Siebel cat. I'm all right. I got the house and the car back. I'm good. But I don't need $37 billion. I couldn't spend it all in many lifetimes. So I'm giving it away. So the community can benefit. So the accumulation of wealth is not for personal self-aggrandizement. You can only eat so much. You can only wear so much. I don't care how many suits you have in the closet, you can only wear one at a time. No matter how many cars you have, you can only drive one at a time. You can't drive one jump out, drive the next, jump out, drive. You can only drive one car at a time. You can only have four wives in this religion at a time. Uh-oh, he was doing all right. You can't leave out any of the religion. I ain't telling the brother to go do nothing. I'm just saying, what your limit is. And most of y'all can't handle that.
You're right.
Even if you had the money, you couldn't handle it. Then women with the four African Americans. Now I love y'all, sister. But four African Americans. Man, you know how to afford he's gonna wind up with a Laquita. Now look at me.
That's right.
Don't get one of them out of the phone. Shaquita gonna show up. And he's gonna be saying, man, I could have just donated that money. I love y'all, sisters. Yeah, with every difficult, there is relief in the ma'al-usri yusra. Barely with the difficulty, there's relief. فَإِذَا فَرَقْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ. So therefore, when you are finished one job, one task, complete your objective, achieve your goal, pick up another challenge, pick up another goal, pick up another purpose, pick up another objective, purpose, don't stop. Pick up another project. Don't stop. وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَرْغَ and turn your attention to your Lord. He's not just the Lord of Israel.
That's right.
He's your Lord.
That's right.
He's your God. He's your Father. He raised us up.
Yes, right.
Turn your attention right. personally. Mm. So look at all that individual responsibility and accountability that's put on us.
That's right.
I don't need any man to tell me what to do. God has told me what to do. Muhammad the prophet has told me what to do. Mm. I respect my teachers. I respect my leaders. Mm. But I'm a man.
Mm.
And I'm a Muslim. Mm. And I have a mind. God gave me that I can use that mind to read the Quran. And what I don't understand, I can ask God, God, please help me to understand your word. And I can read Muhammad's life for myself. I don't need Imam Yahya Abdullah to tell me that. I'm a grown man and a grown woman. And I have an obligation to study my prophet's life. Study my prophet. I'm a messenger. Study my prophet's life. I have an obligation to study him. Because if I'm going to witness that he is the messenger, I need to know something about him. So I can share the witness. And if I'm going to witness God is God, I need to know something about that Allah and his word. I'm not a puppet. I'm not a child if I'm a grown man. I don't need nobody taking me by my hand. Brother, let me show you how to wash your feet. Leave me alone. My mama taught me how to wash. My grandmama taught me. Now all I gotta do is just figure out the methodology of Islam. I already know how to wash my hand. I know how to wash my face. You insulting like that. I know how to wash my feet. You ain't gotta teach me how to take no bath. Are you crazy?
Teach all you.
You think you're talking to me? Grown man. In fact, I smell a little better than you do. I was taught hygiene at home. I know how to brush my teeth. I know how to wash my hair. Now just show me what Islam says. How many times I'm supposed to wash this right here? Okay, I got that, but I know how to wash my hand. What is it? I mean, do you put your feet? I ain't put my feet in that sink. For what?
That's right,
DJ. Taking all this water in the house.
Yeah.
I read the life of the prophet. He said, don't waste the water.
That's right.
Well, you got a pool all in the hallway. Man, get a mop and mop up that water.
You're right,
DJ. Y'all think y'all talking to?
That's right.
You can make yourself a child for him if you like. Not me. And I love him. Mm-hmm. They're not my leader. The man of the Muhammad is. Can't give me no marching orders either. Page 11, as we conclude. From Islam's climate, for business success. Now I'm covering what's on the board. Imam W.D. Muhammad. Allah, through his book, Quran, informs us that if we do good and strive and work for excellence in this world, we are going to receive excellence and get the result of excellence to our credit, recognition, and enjoyment. This is also addressing business people. If business people work for excellence in their business, then their business will be seen for excellence. People will associate the person and the business with excellence. It will be said, you have an excellent product. You give excellent service. But that recognition doesn't come unless you strive for it in the spirit of excellence and goodness. We have another idea about the destiny, he says. We believe Allah points us to the destiny to tell us that to work for the future good is best. To look to the future for results and for establishment. And to plan, like you all are doing with the Imam Ali's Khan Islamic Center. And to plan the long-range plan is better than the disposition to have immediate, quick, benefit-me-now results. As business persons, we all know that to be true. The quick plan, just for today, or just for next week, or next month when the rent is due, to just get the things done are not as important to my life. to my son's life, to my daughter's life, to my wife's life, as will be that long range plan that looks ahead into the future. The long range plan, he says, looks beyond my children to my children's children. That is the way we should think. When you are in business, you should not think of having a business just for your own immediate concerns. If you don't have children, you should think of other relatives and close friends. You should say, I would like to see my relative or close friend inherit what I have. I hope to find one to qualify to take over this business before I leave this life. If that person is younger than you, that is good planning. We should work for the distant future and not just for today or the weekend. This will make our work more effective and long-lasting, and will make our work have more substance now and later. All right? Okay, page 104, 109, and we're done. You all right?
Yes, sir.
I haven't heard anybody's feelings, have I?
Yes, sir.
No intent to do that. We have plans, page 104. We have plans. Now, you all should get this if you don't have it.
Yeah,
read it. I'm reading it over and over.
Yes, sir.
We have, because he laid out a blueprint. We have plans for Muslims in America. The first step for success is to have a look into the future. You see why I selected that? Muslims, along with many religious people, are as travelers in the past. Whether you're riding a modern vehicle or riding a donkey, when you sat on that thing and started moving, you don't look in the present. Your eyes are not concentrated in the present. Your eyes are concentrated in the future. If you concentrate your eyes in the present while traveling or driving, soon you're going to have a bad accident. At any rate, you're going to run off the road. And the vision for the future is a determination to break from excessive dependency. When my father started, there were a few people pushing junk cars, carts, working like a horse or a mule. A big donor had a junk cart as big as some of these pickup trucks. He would load it with rags, paper, cardboard, and scrap metal he found. You would see the secretary, Brother Ephraim Baha, pulling it along the street, bent over like a slave. He would have a heavy belt over his shoulder and attached to his junk wagon. When he came to the temple, he came in with a white shirt and tie, a nice suit with the pants pressed. Ephraim Baha was a man. Here's the conclusion. Hold on, 109. Don't let anybody tell you, Imam Mama says, that there is no money in America for you if you're black. There's plenty of money in America. You have to have some industry in you to get it. Our religion makes it a religious duty to be gainfully and legally employed. You're not measuring up if you're not trying to get employed by legal means, halal means. And now I conclude. I said 109, but this is actually 111, the top part. Look to be like the tree. The tree works for its establishment. It has strong roots that penetrate deep down into the ground. And philosophically speaking, that tree has studied even the rock and takes on its strength. The ebony tree is harder than some rock. There are trees that can break through limestone with their roots looking for water. We don't want to be weak and have our life taken away every time the four seasons go by. What are those four seasons? New president, new election cycle. We pray Allah, brother, get elected again, and we're going to work hard to get him in there. But he only have 4 years left. That season will pass. We want to have lasting establishment, Imam Muhammad says. We must be prepared to exert our mental powers, think hard and penetrate deep like the tree roots. Powerful, solid, and hard to unlock concepts. Strain your brain and penetrate those concepts or problems and send your curious mind down into those rocks so you can grow up tall and strong.
and last year after year. The seasons will come, and you will still be standing there. You won't have to start all over again. Peace be with you. As-salamu alaykum.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
Before we break, I noticed that Imam Taleem Abdul-Samad has come in. I would like him to come up.
He left already.
Okay, I wanted to give him an opportunity to greet us. He's from the Human Resource Center. I'm sorry that he left. Humanitarian. See, that's why we were allowed to correct the speaker. Listen, Imam Yahya Abdullah has some materials here. Sharif Abdul Malik has some materials here, and sister Ebony Khan had some material. I don't know if she left. We're going to break at this time. I'm going to ask you all. Let us show our appreciation for our Imam, who is very close to our leader. Him coming here and making a sacrifice to assist us. We know that we have Masjid Muhammad, we have the New African Islamic Community Center, and we have the Imam Ali Khan Islamic Center. We are one jamia trying to establish al-Islam as it was taught, as it was revealed to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as it was explained to us by our leader, Imam Waraquddin Muhammad. So I thank you, and at this time we're dismissed. As-salamu alaykum. He's coming back in? All right, listen, before you break, we want Imam, Taleb Abdul Samad is my Hajj brother from 1977. Now, I know all you sisters weren't even born then. So I just want to show you that we've been trying to do this for a long time. You go on my wall, you will see, no, he's not on that, he's not in that picture. Imam Muhammad's in that photograph. But he was there. And he was there when the Grand Mufti from Nigeria came and told us, do not call yourself Bilalian. And Imam Taleb Abdul Samad was one of those ones who spoke up and said, you know, you can't teach us against our leader. So is he on the screen?
He's coming back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, let's bring him on. Imam Sultan, I present you Imam Sultan M. Abdullah.
Dear Muslims, dear believers, assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I've been on the program before with my esteemed brother, Imam Yahya Abdullah. It's very difficult to come behind him. But say the least, he has mentioned before many times that he is the companion of Imam Waraquddin Muhammad. And we know that he was one of the close companions. And I myself, too, consider myself as being a companion of Imam Waraquddin Muhammad. Because Yahya said earlier before we start talk that Imam Muhammad had prepared us, and he prepared Imam Yahya for his job, to do what he was doing. And I know, and if you know me, Imam Muhammad prepared me. I spent many, many times with Imam Muhammad. He encouraged me many, many times. I traveled with him. He talked to me personally. I'm not going to say a whole lot about that, but I'm going to tell you what he told me in Mecca. He said, Imam Sultan Muhammad, he said, you are a special man.
Yes, indeed.
I said, what you mean, man? I'm your father. That's the informal remarks. The formal remarks is very quick. And I say informal, because Imam Yahya is one of my teachers. Allah put me with the best teachers. And Imam Yahya Abdullah is one of my teachers. There ain't no coincidence that we're in this masjid. Wherever you pray in, it's a masjid. It may be called Ali Khan Center, but this is a masjid. And we have to respect it that way. There's no coincidence that our host, Imam, is Imam Rauf Muhammad Abdullah. And our guest today is Imam Yahya Abdullah. And the one speaking to you is Imam Sultan Muhammad Abdullah. All of us are servants, all of us are slaves of Allah. And all we do all the time is constantly we are concerned about the condition of our community.
Alhamdulillah.
That's all we do. So, my formal remarks is this. See, man, Muhammad taught us this. He witnessed that God is one. And that he cares for all of his creation, especially his servants and his messengers. And we witnessed that Prophet Muhammad is his servant and his messenger and the seal of the prophets. And we give him the traditional salute or salutation of the prayers and the peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and that's just a perfect thing for the situation right here. This is what Allah says. He says, "Qad aflaha al-mu'minun." And in the proper tense, it don't mean eventually to be successful. Qad means that you are already successful.
That's right.
So I know a little Qalub Arabi and Qasha too. It's a tag. So, Ali Khan, Islamic Community Center, Imam Rauf, Muhammad Abdullah, all of the believers here who are working and struggling here to do this job, as Imam Yahya has said, remember, you are already successful. So this is Imam Muhammad's tafsir. He said, all you have to do now is work your way back. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
You're passing the zakat box around, so.
Yeah. Mr. Believers, we have some food. There's more food than we can eat today. So please come and eat some food and take some with you. But before you get too full, let's make room in our midsection by spending some money here at the our marketplace. Oh, I'm sorry, no, Imam Tala.
Oh, hold on for a second.
I was going to say that Imam Tala couldn't make it back, but he has come back. We would be remiss not to have our esteemed Imam come up here and greet us. I present to you Imam Tala Abdul Samad. Assalamu alaikum.
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا وسيئات اعمالنا واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. First of all, we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. We hope and testify that we never wait to worship Allah. We put our complete trust in Allah, we seek assistance of Allah and His guidance. First and foremost, I want to extend this wonderful invitation, this wonderful gathering, and this effort that you are making, alhamdulillah, to first and foremost continue the great work of our brother Ali Khan, alhamdulillah. For some of you who may not know, Imam Ali Khan, Imam Allah, may Allah forgive his sins and guide him, and make paradise wide for him, is one of my very first teachers back in 1973. As a matter of fact, one of my pursuits of life and passions is a cook. It is he and Brother Sharif Tate who gave me those skills. Alhamdulillah, and brought that gift that I had that I didn't know I had. I'm forever grateful for their companionship. I feel somewhat of a deficiency to come back and come behind Imam Yahya Abdullah. Alhamdulillah, it's great to see him. He's always been a fantastic personality, inspiring speaker, and the guidance and information which he gave you, please take it to heart. As you know, I am also a student of Imam W.D. Muhammad, Allah. Imam Muhammad brought me to the full fold of Islam, along with many of you, in a very historical day at Masjid Muhammad. At that time it was called Muhammad's Temple No. 4. When nearly 20 to 25,000 people gave shahada at one time, declaring the oneness of Allah. I had personal conversations with Imam, and some of the personal conversations that I had with him while we were either at the airport or hotel when I had the opportunity to be in his company, he told me to go and pursue knowledge. He told me personally to get involved with the international community. He told me to go and study the Arabic language. And I took his advice to heart. And since I took his advice, it had, of course, expanded my vision. It expanded my association with the international community of Muslims. But I have never, ever forgot this beginning that we have here. And I just want to let all of you know, continue this great work of Dawah, but don't allow it to cause any type of separation or animosity or division other than righteous competitions with all Muslims. Don't stereotype people just because of what a person may look like, maybe the language or accent or whatever. Don't do that. Focus on yourself. Focus on your development. You know, our Imam Yahya Abdullah spoke very eloquently about the dunya. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't forget our share here. On the other side of that, whenever you see me, you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the akhir. I'm not neglecting my dunya. If so, I wouldn't be working three jobs. Three jobs. Some people ask me, how much more time a day do you need? I say, there's not enough time in the day. This life is so short. But some of you know that I experienced a near-death experience and head-on train collision about in 1998. And the people couldn't realize how I even survived without breaking a bone with the collision. It was Allah. About 3 weeks ago, a month ago, I was pushing a vehicle out of the road with my hands. And I turned around and he was tired screeching. And a woman's coming straight forward between me and the car. And when I turned around and looked at her, just her fender lifted me out. Really wasn't her fender, it was the angels. Lifted me out. So then what is Allah holding me here for? You know, this world, it diverts our attention all the time. It keeps us too busy sometimes. But it says, until we visit the grave, then we will really see it. In other words, the dunya is necessary. We have to have it to feed what? Our material world. But the most important investment that you can make is to get yourself right with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I'm not going to say who goes to paradise and who don't go to paradise. I don't know. But I hope and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I'm one of them. But we don't know that. We can't go just by deeds alone. The reason being, we don't understand the niyyah between a person's deen or their deeds. A person may be given an act of charity, but is that charitable act really amal salihah? Or is it a show off? Is it riyah? A person may invite a person to the deen. Is it to call that person, or is it to make that person who he called grateful to them for the rest of their life? A person may study, but are they studying for the sake of Allah? Or are they studying so people will recognize them as being scholarly? So that's why I never get into the competition about who's going to Jannah, who's not going to Jannah. Because Umar radiallahu anha, and who was the second caliph, he said that if one person would enter the hellfire, he'd think it would be him. And this morning I was teaching the kids, we have a weekend school now, alhamdulillah, we can't even take no more students. We can't even take no more students. And we're talking about Jahiliyyah. And the Umar, in Jahiliyyah, they had what they call infantile. When it was killing female infantile, when it was killing the female babies because it was shameful to the thought of having a female in the birth. And one day Umar radiallahu anhu was crying and he was laughing. He laughed and then he cried. He laughed and then he cried. People say, Umar, why were you laughing and why were you crying at the same time? He said, I was laughing because there was once a time when I made an idol with my own hand, my own food. Then I liquefied it again and I ate it. I laughed. And the second thing, I cried because when I was burying my female child and she reached up and wiped the tear from my eye, I cried. So these are the type of things that we really don't know where we're going, what our real true destiny is. We only can have hope. That's why we say yatamanna. We hope for. But you have to work for it. Whatever you want. One word that Imam Muhammad taught me that I will never ever forget. And he said this. If you expect to get to the hereafter, you have to start here. This is the beginning of it. And I know all of you are real good people. And I think you are people who have the right perspective. And we just ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you that common balance. Don't be too far this way. Don't be too far this way. Be straight in the middle. You know, right in the middle. The middle. Right here. Be balanced. Continue your great work. Thank you for this opportunity. Today, alhamdulillah, our children, my youngest daughter, Aziza, she's involved in, they have what they call a Muslim International Scholastic Tournament every year. And this year she participated in four categories. And alhamdulillah, we hope that today when we go there, she will be successful in some of those with 649 competitors. And inshallah, we hope and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this effort continues to grow. You know, we're right down the street.
Yes, sir.
On Central Avenue.
Yes, sir.
Rohasa, Islamic Research and Humanitarian Services of America. And I want to give you that because we're working together. We're not in competition.
That's right.
You understand? Yes. Many of the brothers who I see there, they come here also.
Yes, sir.
And work together. And that's what some of the things that we're working on in this community now is to stop the growing of centers and less massages, but the growing apart of the unity. We have to keep unity so when people talk to us, they say, oh, I go to this place. MashaAllah. Thank Allah there's a place for you to go. You understand? Do your work, continue your work. Imam Yahya Abdullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Imam Sultan, all the brothers who are involved in great dawah here. And I pray Allah one day I will be able to come back when we see the full reality of your dream. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I just want to express our sincere thanks for supporting us the entire weekend. We started small and we didn't know how it was going to turn out, but we put our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and alhamdulillah, look at the success today. You are here. You were here yesterday. The youth were here. Wonderful. And Friday night you were here. So we at Ali Khan Islamic Center express our sincere thanks. Keep us in your prayers. And as the Imam said before, we are one. Thank you so much.
We're dismissed.
So you got that book too, huh?
Let's go back in. Let's get some bread. Let's get some new suits. I need some new ties.
Good to see you. We have to spotlight that one.
Oh, he switched my thing to 13. Thank you.